Thank you, Reno. And Joel, it's good to be here talking about endobronchial therapies as well. I'm very pleased that as surgeons, we are continuing to be leaders in innovating treatment for emphysema and not delegating this just to our pulmonary colleagues. And this includes the endobronchial therapies that we're talking about now, that first Cliff, and that I will follow along with endobronchial valve treatment. And I just want to disclose that I have received research funding as well as worked as a consultant for Spiration, and this talk does relate to the Spiration intrabronchial valve. So we talked at the beginning session about lung volume reduction surgery. I think that we all established, we're pretty comfortable with the fact that it works. It results in improvement in quality of life, exercise capacity, pulmonary function, and even in some subsets of patients, survival. However, I think we also have to acknowledge that those benefits of lung reduction surgery are offset somewhat by surgical morbidity, prolonged convalescence in many patients, and it's limited to very small subsets of patients that we've been talking about earlier this morning, both in terms of eligibility as well as acceptability to those patients. And then finally, it is expensive and it is irreversible. So this is the template on which we have to look for other alternatives for treating patients with emphysema. And one of these, as introduced by Cliff, is valve therapy. This is the intrabronchial valve developed by Spiration Incorporated, who's a company in Redmond, Washington. They're more famous neighbor being Microsoft, and their wealthier neighbor as well, I might say. So this is a placement of a valve through the working channel of a flexible bronchoscope. So really very simple, unfortunately so simple that it's easily accomplished by a tourist in the airway, including diagnostic bronchoscopists. So the IBV can be placed through the working channel. It's constrained in a sheath. The sheath can be withdrawn, and as it expands, it has these feet that engage it in the distal airway, an upside-down umbrella shape that allows secretions and air to come out from the distal lung, but blocks air going into the distal lung parenchyma, redirecting airflow from upper lung zones to lower lung zones that we'll go over in more detail in a moment. And I'll show you just what that looks like in action. So this is during a bronchoscopy. You can actually see the valve within the sheath, and this is then an effort of looking at the valve, trying to get at the right level of the segmental orifice, and then once it's at the level where you want to release it, there's simply a trigger mechanism on pulling back the sheath that's constraining the valve, and then the valve expands into the segmental orifice, and you can see really complete coverage of that segmental orifice that blocks airflow. But that also allows airflow from distal collateral ventilation to come out due to the shape of the valve. And this shows a couple of valves in place, and you can see how you can obstruct multiple orifices, a whole lobar area with multiple valves placed in the segmental or subsegmental orifices. So I'm just going to review the pilot experience with the intrabronchial valve and then introduce you with what's happening currently in the randomized trial. So the pilot experience was a prospective study, again, to assess safety, like Cliff was talking about with airway bypass, with primary outcome of safety and a secondary outcome of effectiveness, performing bilateral treatment. And now that I've heard David's talk, I guess we should have considered doing unilateral treatment in a staged fashion, but I'm sorry, David, we did decide to do this bilaterally. severe emphysema. These are patients similar to the ones that we're treating for lung reduction surgery, although some of the exclusion criteria were less stringent, as you might anticipate, because these are patients that can tolerate bronchoscopy. They don't have to tolerate a VATS or a sternotomy. And we wanted to exclude patients that had infection, excluded patients that were already listed for either transplant or LVRS. And in this pilot trial, pulmonary rehabilitation was not required. And this is the publication of the initial experience with the intrabronchial valve, published 2 years ago now in the Journal of Thoracic and Cardiovascular Surgery. And the baseline characteristics, I won't go through them in detail. I simply put them up here for you to recognize that these are similar baseline characteristics to other cohorts of severe emphysema patients that we've been treating in other modalities, including lung volume reduction surgery. But I thought you'd be interested in some of the technical details when we're talking about an initial experience. These are a number of valves implanted by patient in the first 30 patients. And you can see that the mean is 6.5 valves, and this is bilateral upper lobe treatment, so essentially treating all segments of both upper lobes except for the lingula. And so that averaged 6.5 valves per patient, and you can see it ranged from 4 to 9 valves per patient. And other technical details, looking at the duration of the bronchoscopy procedure, the average was approximately an hour if we look at the first 30 patients, although it did get better with experience. But it was a range of 15 minutes, so this procedure can be done very quickly, 15-minute procedure in one hand, and a little over 2 hours at the other end of the range. Days in the hospital, these were the required days in the hospital by the protocol. Initially 3, then just an overnight stay. One patient had a COPD exacerbation and was in the hospital for over a month, but every other patient was in the hospital the length of time required by the protocol. If we then look at the whole pilot experience and 91 subjects, as I showed you, there was a median of 6, a mean of 6.7 valves per patient in the total cohort, the procedure time approximately an hour. Valves were successfully placed 99.7% of desired airways, a highly successful, technically straightforward ability to present to get these valves into the correct airway. 75% of them were placed in segmental orifices and 25% in subsegmental orifices. The median length of stay was 1 day, and I showed you the one patient that was skewed, an outsider due to a COPD exacerbation. Interestingly, out of 609 valves, there was no incident of migration, erosion, or expectoration, which really I anticipated. I thought some of these valves are going to be coughed out, some are going to move, and this includes follow-up imaging and follow-up bronchoscopy. And there are no unanticipated adverse events. I'll go over the adverse events that did occur in a moment. We were looking at COPD exacerbation, intubations, a decrease in FEV1, incidence of air leak, lack of benefit, prolonged hospital stay, etc. And ultimately, we looked at the ease of device removal. These valves were designed in a way to allow removal, which I felt was important for any procedure that we were doing that allowed a reversal of the procedure, and we have some experience with that as well. In terms of complications, broken down peri-procedure, immediately post-procedure or after 30 days, you can see that these are in the single digits, things that you would anticipate, bronchospasm, arrhythmia, CO2 retention, hemoptysis, but very small numbers at each level, really a very benign type of procedure, a well-tolerated procedure by the patients. If we look at major morbidity and mortality, looking at the Medicare experience of lung reduction, which we can poke holes in, I know, and the net experience, which we've already talked about, compared to the IBV valve, at least the overall group, and that's the group I would consider here. You can see that mortality at 30 days was 3.3%. There was no periprocedure mortality, air leak of just 2%, and major pulmonary and cardiac morbidity of approximately 3%. I think that's the biggest place where endobronchial therapy is substantially less than a surgical therapy when we look at pulmonary and cardiac perioperative complications. So what about benefit? And as we analyzed these patients, we found that the only place where we saw systematic benefit was in the St. George's respiratory quotient. And if we used a threshold of negative 4 units, approximately 50% of patients early up to 60% at 12 months had met this threshold and had a sustained improvement in the St. George's respiratory quotient. And in fact, if we look at other interventions and how they affect the St. George's respiratory quotient, the top lines are all drug trials. The gray line is lung volume reduction surgery, at least within the net. And the red line is the intrabronchial valve therapy. So you can see that it is not as substantial as lung volume reduction surgery, but more effective than drugs. So it lies somewhere in between medical therapy and surgical therapy for improvement in symptoms. And if we look at more objective measures of improvement, many of the things that we look at, there were not any other objective measures of improvement in this pilot study. Total lung capacity, residual volume, 6-minute walk, really not meaningfully different, and that is also true for FEV1, which raised the question of how does this work? Why are patients symptomatically better, or is this just a placebo effect? So it appears that the valves redirect airflow to lower lung areas instead of upper lung areas, and I'm going to show you the data for this. The treated upper lobes are smaller, but overall lung volumes are unchanged, and it appears that this change in lung volumes correlates with symptoms. And if we look at so this is what's happening. We're redirecting airflow from upper lung zones to lower lung zones. And this shows it quantitatively. These are CT scans that look at volumetric data. And if you look at upper lobe volume change, you see that a majority of patients have a decrease in upper lobe volumes. And this is the same group of patients looking at lower lobe, non-upper lobe, or in most cases lower lobe volume. And you can see an increase in lower lobe volumes. And so you can see that this is not going to result in a change in lung volumes overall. It's actually a low bar shift. And this looks at it another way, a decrease from baseline of upper lobe lung volume and an increase from baseline in non-upper lobe volume from treatment with the intrabronchial valve. So the intrabronchial valve appears to result in lobar volume reduction rather than overall lung volume reduction, with probable a shift in volume and blood flow that improves ventilation perfusion and therefore symptomatic improvement. It may also blunt dynamic hyperinflation. That's a harder thing to measure. And LVRS may also have an interlobar shift, but obviously we're directly resecting lung in those patients. So currently, we're at the late stages. It probably will be closing either end of 2009 or beginning of 2010, a randomized control trial. This is a pretty exciting trial because this is a sham-controlled procedure trial where the control group is also having a bronchoscopy. They're having manipulation of their airway. They're not having valves placed. They're blinded to whether they had a treatment. They're not allowed to look at their own x-rays. There's a separate cohort of physicians that do not know the treatment assigned that is following those patients and assessing their outcomes. So this is kind of an old-fashioned sham control trial to try to assess whether there's a placebo effect of intrabronchial valve therapy that is the reason for benefit in the pilot trial. So As I said, there's two study teams. I'm in our own center. I'm the treatment study team, so I know what treatment they got, and then I don't see the patients after that. And I have another team that follows the patient and is not aware of the treatment assigned. The primary measures are collected at 6 months. The trial is now recruiting, and if any of you are interested in it, the website is there at the bottom of the slide. There was a trial finished earlier this year in Europe, which was somewhat similar. It was a randomized single-blind sham procedure-controlled trial with a three-month lead-in, and then crossover was allowed. And this, I don't know the results. I was not at the ERS meeting, and these were the centers in Europe that participated in this trial. So endobronchial treatment for emphysema is a likely alternative to lung volume reduction surgery. It's not clear that it requires actual lung reduction and control of collateral ventilation, as Cliff has shown. In fact, his collateral ventilation may be a benefit for procedures like airway bypass. But we're all familiar with the fact that emphysema patients are a heterogeneous group of patients. It's pretty clear, I think, that lung reduction is still going to be a good operation for a certain number of those patients. Transplant is going to be the best treatment for another group of those patients. And yet we have some new techniques that may be the best option for some patients either at an earlier stage of their disease or as an alternative to surgical therapies that we already offer. But we as surgeons need to be involved in evaluating the complications and the efficacy of these therapies and continuing to bring this science to our own group and be engaged in the endobronchial therapies as much as we're engaged in the surgical therapies. So we may go from the surgical procedure to an endobronchial procedure, not quite as exciting for us in this room, but having a patient that's in a chair instead of in a bed, and a patient that's on a treadmill rather than in the ICU a day after surgery. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Doug, for an excellent presentation. We are coming now to the last presentation in this session.